So welcome to the last day of calculus.
All right. So we're going to do a couple more solutions to equations using Newton's method. And then we'll move on to a new topic. Okay, so then, for example, solve 2x squared minus 8x plus 3 is equal to 0 in the interval 3 to 4 using Newton's method. So as a reminder, that formula that you need to memorize is xn plus 1 is xn minus the function at xn divided by the derivative of the function at xn. So on such an exercise, the way it'll always be stated is 1, find an initial value, and the update formula. And then 2, iterate to convergence and then I'll say something. So on this one, I'll say 4 places past the decimal. Okay, so what is this? What does all this stuff mean? So what would be a good initial value?
2x squared minus 8x plus 3. Oh, no. You're talking about 3.5.
Yeah, 3.5 would be a good initial value. Why would 3.5 be a good initial value? It's halfway between 3 and 4. Okay. So, then the update formula, well, that's going to be xn plus 1. Is xn, and then minus what is in the numerator?
2x squared minus 8x plus 3.
Yes, 2x squared minus 8x plus 3. And then what goes, and that should be n's, right? xn and xn. And then what goes in the denominator?
4xn minus 8.
Very good. 4xn minus 8. So is there any question about finding the update formula? And now what is the meaning of this second request?
We have to plug in 3.5 and keep solving.
Yeah, you plug in 3.5 into this and you get a value. And then you plug that value into this and you get another value. And you plug that value into this and get another value. And you keep doing this, you keep iterating this procedure until this has been met. The 4 places past the decimal are not changing anymore. So, let's do that. And now is probably a pretty good time for you to try this out. Okay, so I'm getting
X2 is 3.5833. X3 is 3.5811. And X4 is 3.5811.
Okay, so then that means that I can stop. Why does that mean I can stop? Because now four places past the decimal, I'm getting the same value. Okay, now, if you're wondering how did I accomplish it that fast, because this is the sequence of buttons that I typed into my calculator. So I typed 3.5, and then I pressed enter. And what that does is that puts 3.5 into the value of Anne's answer. Then I typed ANS minus parentheses 2 times ANS caret 2 minus 8 times ANS plus 3, and then divide 4 times ANS minus 8. So I typed this into my calculator, and then I pressed enter 1, 2, 3 times. Okay, so any question about this one?
So we just have to document each time you press enter, basically.
Right. Yeah, you don't need to type all this. You don't need to write all this. Yeah, just this. Yeah. Any questions about this? Okay, let's do another one. Let's solve e to x plus x is 2 on 0 to 3 using Newton's method. And again, the same instructions. Find the initial value and the update formula. Once you've done that, iterate to convergence 4 places past the decimal. Okay, so what do you think would be a good initial value? How about 1.5?
Okay, now here's something that's, the next question is slightly more complicated. What is the function that, remember, Newton's method, what it does is it solves function equal to zero. So essentially you need an equation where one of the sides is zero. So what do we do? Right. So then you need to take the equation and move all of the terms to one side. And it doesn't matter what you do. What I mean is, I imagine that all of you moved the 2 to the left-hand side. But you could have moved these to the other side. That'd have been fine as well. So to be clear, the function that we're using is e to x plus x minus 2. So that's the function we're using. So the update formula is x n plus 1 is x n minus e to x plus x minus 2, and then divide by what? E to x plus 1. Okay, so any question about finding the update formula? Was it not converging?
It took a really long time, and that's why.
Yeah. It'll net on the questions that I give you, if you've done it correctly.
It will take 12 steps.
It should not take 12 steps. It shouldn't take 12. It should never take more than like 6 steps. Okay, so we have an update formula. What's being requested now in part 2? Right, just keep doing it over and over and over again, right? Okay, so let's do it. So the first number I'm getting is 0.7736. And then 0.4765. Zero point 4432. Zero point 4429. And then 0.4429. Okay. That's interesting, right? Because this equation that I gave you, you have no means to solve it analytically. What I mean is that if I was to give you a quadratic equation, say, then you could use the quadratic formula, and you could tell me exactly what the answer is using the quadratic formula. But this equation, you don't have the means to solve it analytically. And what I'm saying is, it's not that you specifically as a person don't have it. I'm saying that there isn't one. There's not a way to analytically solve this. Nevertheless, using Newton's method, we can numerically approximate the solution to arbitrary accuracy. And in the end, in the real world, that's really all that's necessary. Okay, you know, if you look closely at the screen, then you can see little purlin noise in the screen, because the pixels are not exactly white all the time. They're actually flickering close around a value that's close to white, and you can see it, and that's good enough, right?
Or, for a more dramatic example, the Mars Science Laboratory was sent to Mars and landed. And the whole purpose was to get it to land in a 100-kilometer ellipse. And it landed almost right in the middle of that ellipse. But landing anywhere in that ellipse would have been enough, right, for the mission. It's quite incredible that they landed almost dead center in the mission ellipse. It's incredible, right? So then 100 kilometers accuracy is good enough for landing on Mars. 100 kilometers is not good enough for performing surgery. It's not going to work. We need something better than that. Okay, any question about this? And so we're going to move away from this now to a new topic, but I do want to stress, like, this technique of solving nonlinear equations numerically is like one of the top things in all of math and science. So we all came in here with our various devices today, like here's this camera, and then we probably all of us have a cell phone, a computer, a tablet, or whatever. Your devices probably are solving nonlinear equations just like this, even now. Okay, all the time. Good. Any questions before we move to a new topic?
A new topic.
Okay. So this is section 12.7, and it's called L'Hôpital's rule. So L'Hôpital, that's a French name, and that O has a diacritic over it, a caret, a pointy hat. And that's pronounced L'Hôpital. Well, anyway, that's the way an English-speaking American says L'Hôpital. Right? I'm sure that's not quite exactly right. Now, concerning that name, just as a brief remark, obviously in English we don't have that. We don't have this accent marks. So typically the way it's written, like if you wanted to look it up on YouTube or Google or whatever, then you'd type this. And yes, that does look like hospital, but that when you are pronouncing this word in the French style, it's L'Hôpital. Okay? Any question about the name? Okay, so L'Hôpital's rule is about computing limits. So, for example, here is a limit. And you could have done this limit, or a limit just like this, and maybe even we did, if we look back in the notes, do exactly this one. So when on day one, when we walked in, how did we handle such a limit? By plugging in. Okay, so then can you plug in 1? It's not equal to 0.
Oh, it's indeterminate.
It's 0/0, right? It's indeterminate. Okay, so that means we need to play around with this to try and figure out what it is we're supposed to do. So what do?
Factor.
Okay, factor the numerator. So the limit as x goes to 1, and then the numerator factors as x plus 1 multiplied by x minus 1, and then the denominator is x minus 1. And then, okay, so what's the observation now?
You can cancel.
Okay, you can cancel. So I canceled the x minus 1s. And then now, how about this? Now you can plug in, right? You get 2. Okay, and notably, I'd like to point out again, right? If this was all that was written, like this, okay, why is it incorrect? Because it's not how math works. Okay, I agree, but can you be more specific?
You can't cancel out, even if it's factored, because, I don't know. Oh, because it might be zero?
Because you don't get the same answer. It's actually a different formula.
Okay. I'm fishing for a D word. derivative is a D word, but that's not the D word I'm fishing for. Starts with D, ends with omain.
Domain.
Yeah.
Domain. That one.
Yeah, that one. So this expression right here, can you plug one into this expression?
Yes.
Yes. Can you plug one into this one?
No.
No, you cannot. And neither can you plug one into the first. So these expressions are not all equivalent. They're not the same expression because their domains are different. Okay, so then all of that high school time where you were psychologically conditioned to always cancel factors all the time, right? Where high school instructors are saying that. In fact, that's a half-truth. You cannot cancel except in certain circumstances. These are not equivalent expressions, but their limits are equivalent, because what this limit is saying is you're getting close to one, but not at one. So are these expressions the same everywhere except at one? Yes, they are the same, and therefore their limits are the same. Okay, good. So how about this one? It's indeterminate, right? Because the numerator is obviously zero. And then what's e to zero?
One,
and then minus one, that's zero. Okay, so now what? Yeah, so on the previous exercise, we sort of played an algebra game and then finessed away the problem algebraically. Here we can't do anything with this. There's nothing algebraic you can do to get the problem that's occurring at zero to go away. So by the end of this section, we want to be able to handle this limit. We want to be able to deal with this. Okay. Presently, with the tools that we've talked about in this class, you don't have a tool to handle this. Okay. So that being said, I'm going to give you the definition of all the indeterminate forms. I think I did this near the beginning, and your Calculus 1 instructor should have done it, but we'll just do it here. So there is the product indeterminate form. So the product indeterminate form is 0 times infinity. Right, 0 times any finite number is 0. But what about 0 times infinity? What's that? Hard to say. It's indeterminate. So there's the ratio indeterminate forms. So what are the ratio indeterminate forms? 0 over 0 is one of them. And there's another. Well, the only other thing would be non-zero. 0 over non-zero is 0.
What about infinity?
Yeah, that one. Infinite over infinite. Okay, and by infinite over infinite, I mean that could mean positive infinity over positive infinity, negative infinity over positive infinity, you know, variations on that. Okay, then there's the
sum and difference. So you could have negative infinite plus infinite, or infinite minus infinite. So the reason why these are called indeterminate is because, you know, 0 over 0, you know, it kind of looks like you ought to be able to cancel the zeros, right? In the sense that you could cancel 5 over 5. That would work. But you cannot cancel the zeros. Similarly, you cannot cancel the infinities. And, you know, if this was an 8, negative 8 plus 8, well, that'd be 0. They'd cancel. But negative infinity plus infinity does not cancel. Okay, and that doesn't cancel either.
Is there a different size of infinity?
There are many different sizes of infinity. Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, it's a logical consequence of the axioms that
really
we use.
Not logical at all. There's nothing logical about that.
Okay.
Agree.
All right, well.
No hotels.
All right, we won't get into the hotel there. Okay. The exponential and determinate forms are 0 to 0 and 1 to infinity. So these are, for all practical purposes, the indeterminate forms for our class. So here we go. Proposition. So this proposition is L'Hôpital's rule. So let f and g be functions which are differentiable on an open interval containing x is equal to c and the limit as x goes to c of f of x over g of x is an indeterminate ratio. What does that mean?
One of our indeterminate forms.
Right, not just any of them.
Oh, it's the ratio.
One of the ratio ones, right?
0 over 0 or infinity.
Right. Then there's two consequences. One, if the limit as x goes to c of f of, now I'm writing this in red so you won't miss it, the derivative of f of x divided by the derivative of g of x is L, then the limit as x goes to c of f of x over g of x is L. So what this first bit is saying is that, well, suppose you're computing a limit and you observe that it's an indeterminate ratio. Then what you can do is you can differentiate the numerator and differentiate the denominator and then compute the limit. And if that limit is, say, 5, then the original limit is also 5. Okay? So second,
if the limit as x goes to c of the derivative of f of x over the derivative of g of x does not exist, then neither does the original. Okay, so this is called L'Hôpital's rule. It's a way to have another tool to proceed when the limit is an indeterminate ratio. So one thing I do want to say about this before we go any further is that this mathematical theorem proposition actually is not due to L'Hôpital at all. It's actually due to one of the Bernoulli brothers. There were several people with family name Bernoulli who did a lot of stuff in math and science. And one of their contemporary humans was a rich banker named whose name was L'Hôpital. And L'Hôpital straight up just paid one of the Bernoulli brothers and said, "You know what? I just want to give you some money and I want you to name that after me." And their their Bernoulli brothers said, "Yeah, all right, yeah, let's do that." The check cleared, so let's do it. Okay. Incredible. Bought and paid for.
Incredible.
Okay.
Shows that you don't really know
how to do that. Oh, yeah, I mean. Yeah, I mean, just think of all the things that are named after Rockefeller, right? I mean, he did stuff, you know, he made a lot of money, but half the stuff that's named after him had really nothing to do with him and everything to do with the money he gave everyone. Mm-hmm. So let's do that. Let's do that limit that we were doing two pages ago. So the limit as x goes to 0 of x squared over e to x minus 1. Okay, and we established that, okay, well, this limit is indeterminate. So is it an indeterminate ratio?
Yes.
Yes? And so what that means is that, oh, this is a sick limit. And what do we do with sick limits?
We take them to the hospital.
We take them to the hospital. That's right.
That was awesome. I think that was the best joke of the whole time.
Well, I had to go out on a high note, you know.
Do we need to put that notation in the LH?
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
So that the grader knows
what the heck we're doing.
What you're doing. So what's the derivative of the numerator?
2x.
And the derivative of the denominator? E to x, right? So how about this limit now? It's 0, right? Because if you plug in the limit point, what is the numerator?
0.
And what is the denominator? 1. Well, 0 over 1, that's 0. Okay. So it's not quite as bad as you might have thought. Okay.
Yeah, easy. For now. On example 1.
That's sick.
Sick limit, yeah.
Do we have to? I mean, why do we have to do the little LH?
So that the grader knows what you're doing.
Know what we're doing?
Well, I mean, the grader, you know, is in graduate school, so So they know all this math that you know. But the thing is that, you know, when you're doing these wild and crazy limit things, this is the thing. Imagine trying to be a grader, okay? And you see something that a student has done, and it's not right. Now you're trying to figure out, to what extent is it not right? Because you're trying to assess partial credit. Okay, and if you do something that isn't clear, where the grader's not sure, did they even try L'Hopital's rule? I mean, it's not right, but... So, yeah, you want to declare what you're doing to the grader. So that they'll know, well, okay, they knew that they needed to do L'Hopital's rule. They just didn't do it right. Whereas if you attempt L'Hopital's rule but somehow mess it up entirely, it's not clear that you tried L'Hopital's rule at all. Okay. So how about what else? No, I don't like that one. Okay, how about the limit as x goes to 1 of the log of x in the numerator divided by x minus 1 all squared in the denominator. What do you think? So can we just plug in?
No, it's sick.
No, it's a sick limit. Very good. So we got to take it to the hospital. See, you were wondering when I was going over the pronunciation and spelling of the of L'Hopital. You were wondering, why are we even talking about this? It's so we can make this joke for the next 15 minutes. Okay, so what's the derivative of the numerator?
1 over x.
1 over x. And the derivative of the denominator?
2x minus 1.
Very good.
2x minus 2.
Sure. Okay. So now what?
Plug in.
Okay, so if you were to plug in the numerator, plug 1 into the numerator, what would you get? 1. And how about the denominator?
0.
Zero.
So it doesn't exist.
So this is undefined or does not exist. Any question about this one?
Does it get more difficult?
A little bit. Let's do one.
I think that we only have an hour. 30 minutes left to calculate. It shouldn't get any longer. We should leave on a high note. An easy high note.
So when you're looking at the derivatives of these, you don't look at them that it's in the denominator. You just strictly look at what's sitting up there.
It's not like a ratio. It's one
function. Right,
but you're
not looking at it from a perspective it's in the denominator.
No.
Right. You're just strictly looking at what's on top.
It's two functions.
Yeah.
Two separate
functions. One function in the numerator,
yeah.
Another.
We're not talking about doing the
quotient rule. No, none of that. None of that. Unless the numerator
happens
to be a quotient, yes. Right?
And then that's just obnoxious.
Right.
And here it comes. And here it comes.
Here it is.
And here it comes.
By request.
No, there was no request.
No. So now I'm going to ask a question, but don't respond. But don't respond. Who used L'Hopital's rule?
Nobody, because she
pointed
out the answer.
No one, I hope.
Sorry.
However, you know, I'm going to, in all likelihood, I'm going to ask a question about L'Hopital's rule in 5 days. Okay? And I'm going to give a question just like this, and someone's going to use L'Hopital's rule. They're going to get a zero for that. So can you use L'Hopital's rule?
No.
No, you cannot. Why can you not use L'Hopital's rule?
Because it's not indeterminate.
It's not an indeterminate ratio. Is this in the form 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity?
No.
No, it is not. This is not an indeterminate ratio. This does not meet the requirements of L'Hopital's rule.
So
you can't use it.
Trick us.
I'm not going to trick you. I mean, this is something you could have done on the first day.
I agree. But, you know, when your mind's thinking, oh, I need to remember L'Hopital's rule, what you think is, I need
yeah.
to do it.
When you have in your hand a hammer,
that's right. I want to bang things.
Everything looks like a nail.
Have a problem.
Okay. Let's continue. How about this one? The limit as x goes to 0 of e to x minus 1 and then divided by about x squared. Good. So why do you think I gave this particular exercise?
Because we get an instrument ratio.
Okay.
Even after. Is there like an ICU or something?
An ICU, yeah. Yeah, right. Good. Good. So it's an indeterminate ratio to begin with. Right? So that means, okay, we'll take it to the hospital. And so when you do that, the new numerator is e to x minus 1, and the new denominator is 2x. And it's still an indeterminate form.
Does that just mean 2 is pretty bad? We can't figure
it out. No, that means do it again.
Oh.
Right? So, yeah, I like it. Now, so you went to the hospital, and now we're still to the ICU, right? So one more time here. So now is the limit of e to x over 2. How about that? Half. So the takeaway from this is that if I can give you an exercise where L'Hopital's rule is required twice in a row,
you'll probably do it.
Then I can do it arbitrarily many times, right? I could make it to where you have to use L'Hopital's rule 7 times.
That would be really
nice. That would be nice. So
yeah, why would you want to grade that, really?
But that's okay.
That's the main question.
I know.
Why would I want to do that to myself?
Yes. Let's be selfish here. I say everyone sitting in this room should just get an A.
That would simplify everything.
You don't have to grade anything else.
It would make it so much easier.
Yeah. I know, that's right. There's not that many people in here. Wouldn't that be good? Be that big of a deal? And we would all keep it in between ourselves.
Oops. Okay, so we got a.
I'm trying again.
We got a. So L'Hopital's rule, L'Hopital's rule still works for limits at infinity. That is to say, when you say the limit as x goes to infinity or something like that. And also for one-sided limits. Which is to say, like, the limit as x goes to 5 from the left.
It's a really random question. How many proofs do they have to be before it's proven? Like, how many times do they have to do this before they say yes, it's always true?
L'Hopital's rule?
Mathematicians in general.
No, it's proven once and for all.
No, I know, but you have to do it over and over again. When you're coming up with a new rule, you have to do it over and over and over again in many different ways before it's proven.
No, I mean there. I mean, if you're interested, I can produce for you a mathematical proof. I'm not gonna do it here.
I'm not. I just wanted to.
But no, I mean, I could do it in a.
I wanted a couple pages. A one-word answer. You have to prove it this many times before it's proven.
No, it's proven in the sense that it's just proven. It doesn't require. It's not like, oh, it worked for 10 examples, so it must be true.
Yeah.
It's not like that. No, okay. It's a proof. Like.
This is
the way it is.
Okay.
It's a logical consequence of the axioms that we've selected.
Okay.
Yeah, and coming up with proof is, you know, that's.
Oh, I see. Coming up with a proof that is. I understand now.
Right.
You have to come up with an example that. Would disprove any other option, but it being true.
Right. So let me think of an example.
Oh gosh, I'm sorry, guys.
No.
Oh boy.
I'm so sorry. It even takes a little rabbit
trail. I mean, we proved some things in our class, right? What do we prove? What do we prove in here? Did we prove the fundamental theorem?
Yes.
Yeah, we did.
We did.
We spent about 30 minutes doing it.
Okay, well, that means that it's true.
Okay.
It's true for any function which is continuous.
Okay.
It's true for even more functions than continuous functions. Mm-hmm. But what we proved in class is it's true for every continuous function that there is.
Mm-hmm.
So if I give you a continuous function, I guarantee it's true for it.
Okay.
So how about this one? The limit as x goes to 0 from the left of x multiplied by the log of x. Yeah, so one of the games that mathematicians play is that, you know, like in golf, you're trying to get the ball in the hole with the fewest strokes possible.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a thing called math golf, which is where you're trying to prove a result using the least of something possible, like the least amount of other results as possible, or you're trying to use the least amount of pages as possible. Right, the shortest, most concise possible proof.
Mm-hmm.
So that math golf. Yeah. So how about this? What do you think? So what's the limit of x as x goes to 0 from 0, right? So
So that first, this term, it's 0. How about log of x as x goes to 0 from the right? It's not 1. The log of 1 is 0.
What is it? What was the question?
What does the green factor do as x goes to 0 from the right? So the question is, in a sense, could be phrased as, what does the plot of log of x look like? So what does it look like? It looks like this. So if you were to follow the green to x is 0, where would you go? To negative infinity. All right. So this is 0 multiplied by negative infinity. Well, how about that? 0 multiplied by negative infinity. What is that? It's indeterminate. Can we use L'Hopital's rule? No. Cannot. Why can you not use L'Hopital's rule? It's not a ratio. Right? It's a product. You can't use L'Hopital's rule on an indeterminate product. You can use it on an indeterminate ratio. So what we want to do is we want to take this product and turn it into a ratio. Okay, so then here's my hint to you. So multiplying by 2 is the same as dividing by what? By half. Multiplying by 2 is the same as dividing by half. That's my hint, I claim.
Multiplying. So you want to divide by 1 works.
Right. So the limit as x goes to 0 from the right of log of x in the numerator, and then what do I need to write in the denominator?
1 over x.
1 over x. So now, under normal circumstances, you wouldn't rewrite multiplication by x as division by 1 over x. It's correct, but under normal circumstances, you wouldn't write that. But what is the function of what is the purpose of having done that? So it's an indeterminate ratio now, because look at 1 over x. So this green one, that's log of x. And then what does 1 over x do? What does 1 over x look like? Right, it's the standard hyperbola, this one. So if you, this is 1 over x. If you follow the red to x is 0, where do you go? Positive infinite. So now this is in the form negative infinite over infinite. And now you can say, oh, this is a sick limit. I see it now. So let's take it to L'Hopital. Okay, so what's the derivative of log x?
1 over x.
1 over x. And then what is the derivative of that? 1 over x. So we computed the derivative of the numerator. Now what's the derivative of the denominator? It's been too long. Okay, well then just follow your nose. Do it. Something like that. So the derivative of 1 over x, well, that's the derivative of x to negative 1, right? Yes. So negative 1 x times x to negative 2 which is, yes, negative 1 divided by x squared. Okay, so that's information that you gotta know. Okay.
Don't have an example where we go from here. Yeah. That's the problem. Sure. You get negative x.
Right. So now I wanna observe that. Well, do you see that it's still in an indeterminate ratio? Mm-hmm. So can we use L'Hopital's rule from here? Yes, we could use it. Should we use it?
No.
No.
Just solve it.
Yeah, we should perform algebraic simplifications now, right? What did you learn first, algebra or L'Hopital's rule?
Algebra.
Algebra. So you should do that first, right? So dividing by a fraction is the same as multiplying by its reciprocal. So that'd be 1 over x multiplied by x squared over negative 1. And then that simplifies. To negative x. Okay, and how about that limit? It's 0.
Even though there's negative?
Okay, it's negative 0.
I don't.
You don't like negative 0? Well, negative 0 is the same as 0.
Okay.
Unless you're on. Just stop there. No, actually, on your computers, there is, depending on the floating point unit in your computer, the floating point value of 0 may have a sign, an SIGN. So it depends on the IEEE specification of your floating point unit in your computer, and it does make a big difference to applied mathematicians to know whether or not you have assigned 0. And I'm an applied mathematician. I mean, there's various kinds, right? But that's the kind that I am. Any question about this one? Okay. Do we want to do any more of these? I think not. So now it's open for review. So I asked for you to bring questions. So if you have any questions, please bring them.
I know when we come in.
Yes?
Are you releasing something so we can kind of practice? Because there's no online stuff now.
There's three online homeworks.
You just released them?
Today.
Okay.
The three online home, there are three, okay, that's actually, there's five online homeworks. Two of them are due tomorrow night. Three.
Oh yeah, that I already done.
That's normal. Three more of them are over this week.
Okay.
They're never due. They're not
part,
they're not part of your grade.
Okay.
But I encourage you to do them for practice.
Okay. And there's no more written homework.
No more written homeworks will be turned in after these. I'll write a few more questions that you could do as if they were written homeworks, but they won't be collected.
And do we know which have you said which of the questions are going to be the review?
Because the number was so small, I said any of these. So you got to study all the quiz questions.
So you said you can bring, like I did a spreadsheet showing.
Just like that.
So you're going to have every quiz question available? Is that
no.
What you're
saying?
No. There's 30 quiz questions or so. And I'm going to bring 20 quiz questions.
But we don't know what 20 those are.
Right.
Okay. And you will drop our lowest quiz grade.
The lowest one.
The lowest
one. One quiz or one exercise?
One exercise.
What?
So you're going to redo 8 exercises. And besides that, and then after all of that reckoning is reckoned, I'll drop the whatever.
Reckoning.
You'll drop the lowest one that was graded.
graded.
No, no. After you do 8 redo exercises, okay,
right,
you'll still have 30 quiz exercises, except the eight that you redid may have changed the values of those, right?
Right.
So if on quiz 7,
hopefully
question 2,
you made a
2 the first go round, and the second go round you made an 8, then you'll have an 8.
Right.
Then after, so after that, after all the redo is calculated, you'll have 30 exercises. I'll drop the lowest one.
So basically, we better hold the wish that out of the 20 exercises you're going to bring, the 8 that we choose, or like to like know, like.
Well, I think
know,
just bring up the ones that you want to bring.
Right.
Yeah, that's right. It's for sure.
All
and then I'll
next
to it.
Seriously. Okay,
so
just study all 30.
Yeah,
which
study.
I am.
Study all 30.
Okay.
I mean, so. The purpose of this procedure is, okay, is that I want you to exit at the highest possible knowledge level.
Yeah.
So there's lots of carrot and stick going on here, right? So I'm, you know, some of you don't like the grades that you made on quizzes. Fine, I get it. So you have chances. You have chances to redo them.
You said there was a 4 and 5. Okay, so I'll have 4 and 5. And then what if they'll find even on the 20?
Well, then, you know, if you got to...
I mean, I'll study. I'm not going to study it, but...
Yeah, I agree. There's some probabilities involved. Right?
So you better, okay.
But, I mean, it can only be up to 8 because that's the labor cap.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it will be including the quizzes from this week. The possibility...
14 and 15, yes.
So there is possibility of those questions being on there as well.
Yes. Okay.
No, it is awesome.
Okay, good.
Didn't study well enough.
Okay, so is any more procedural questions?
So the bonus questions on our written homework, how were those calculated? Because some of them just show C.
So if it was a bonus question that was not actually graded, the way it works is that written homeworks are out of 10. Graded written homeworks are out of 10. Ones that are for out of our completion are out of 1. Well, they have
there's
to be because they're not graded.
Yeah, there's a lot less of them, or there's a lot more.
Oh, I see what you're saying, because if it's a bonus question, then it's graded.
It's a bonus question. It should be an additional. You know,
it should be. It should be.
I would assume
it should. It should be 10 out of 0. You know,
because if somebody didn't attempt the bonus
just
question,
it doesn't hurt.
It doesn't hurt that. The person who tried to do it.
Yeah.
Then you get a point.
Huh?
Then you get a point.
An extra point, though.
Yeah. And it's not part of the denominator, it's only part of the numerator.
Numerator, right, okay.
Yes?
If we got a 3 on 2 different questions and on our quizzes, that means that one of them will be, that's my lowest, one of them will be dropped and one of them I absolutely want to retake. We're not allowed to retake more than an 8, and so to make sure that I'm not retaking the one that's going to be dropped, I'm just kind of trying to figure out how to make sure that I don't, because if I redo both of them, one of those will be dropped, right? And so
No. You've got 30 marks in the grade book. Okay. After the final exam, you'll have 8 more marks. Okay.
Then
I'll take those and I'll select the highest. So for example, if your quiz 7 question 2, you got a 2 on, and your redo you got an 8 on, then you'll have an 8.
Okay.
Then now you have a new set of 30 that have been up to 8 of them have been changed. Then I'll drop the lowest one. Because there's been 15 quizzes, and we grade 2 quizzes, 2 exercises per quiz.
I thought I read somewhere that said that it might not just be graded questions.
The questions that are going to appear on the redo
could come from anywhere. I could just make up a new one, for example. I could.
But it will be a replacement.
But it'll be
kind
of.
But it'll be a replacement.
Of a graded question, not of a.
Not like.
Not of a non-graded question, obviously.
Right.
So even
yes.
if it's different than what the graded question was,
it's
still,
just not going to look.
It'll still
right.
replace the graded question.
Right.
Yeah, I have a question.
That's more than
not too much.
This is turning out to be complicated to understand.
It's very complicated.
Not this year, but when will like the final grade be like in the grade books?
I'm going to ask the graders to be finished grading on Thursday.
Thursday, okay.
Awesome.
Thursday.
Then I'll be scanning for 6 hours.
Okay.
So do you think we'll have our grades by
Friday? Probably, probably Thursday or Friday.
It's the same material, the same question, the same
thing.
I don't care.
So when we good take
news.
Out
many
Thursday, good news on Friday,
I'm going to have anything in front of us.
Right.
And I don't have a watch. So are you going to...
There'll be a timer.
Okay.
Will you project it?
It'll be up on. It'll be on the projector.
No, that's where it's done. Good.
Well, no, go. You can finish it if you want, but I want it.
But you make. You'll make us sit here for 30 minutes, no matter what, right?
Right. Please. Yes. I need.
I
need you to.
I will not get done less than 30 minutes.
Okay.
I will not get done less than 30 minutes. There's
no
way.
No, we are kicked out till 7:45.
Right.
Because I'm not leaving.
Yeah. I mean.
Yeah, it's all going to be up there.
So I have my OBHR class, our finals on Tuesday at 5 as well, which I don't know how that happened because I thought like everything.
No, your instructor must have made an error.
It's Wednesday.
It's Wednesday.
He said
you should check carefully, because the thing is that the registrar calculates the times of final exams so that there's no overlap.
Maybe
yeah.
Okay, I don't have any emails from him. I
would guess that either your instructor made an error in the email, or you misread.
Our exam for that class is the 10th, and our final exam for this class is the 9th.
Okay, so any other questions? Because we can... we can review now for the exam.
Oh, okay.
Instead of just procedural questions.
You can go through 8 problems that you're going to give
us. just start from the beginning.
No.
Just
you don't want that you might think will be on there?
Just so you said the 11-3, you're reasking us. I'm guessing that's because perhaps overall,
yeah, my two-year-old.
Performance on question 11-3 was terrible.
So are there any other questions?
Well, yeah.
No, do you know of any other questions that...
Not off the top of my head.
Okay.
What is
I can go to mine.
Probably tomorrow.
Right
now. No, question 11-3 was not graded. It was going to be graded. But I thumbed through it and thought, no, nah, we can't grade this one. This is bad. So, okay, so let's get to it. To doing calculus. So what do you want to see?
What's going to be on quiz? 14 and 15.
Something just like question 11-3. Is going to be on quiz 14.
We already put that on YouTube, though.
Did
you?
Did I? Yeah.
All of them are on 11-3 was where we sketched it.
Can you do a problem about finding the area of something? Hold on, I'll find one.
How about one that where you're sketching the region like that?
Sure.
That's what 11-3 is about. It was terrible.
Why would you do that? I don't understand. That was really bad.
Everybody got it wrong?
No. But it looked like... It looked like about 10 people got it right. It was not good.
I'm pretty sure I wrote my own on that one.
We'll do it.
The one with the X and 2X?
Yeah.
No, it was the one after that one.
What?
The one I practiced was
11-3 was that
one.
Well, 11-3 was the one where it was Y equals X and Y equals X squared.
Yeah.
Yeah, sketch a region? Yeah. Yeah, that one. Oh, okay. That one.
Oh man, I don't even know what I'm looking for.
I sketched it.
I haven't even looked at that one yet because I didn't write anything.
Okay.
I'm sorry, just one more question.
Yes?
Before you started, all of the quiz grades are out of 10.
That's right.
So, like, all of them poorly on a 1 or a 2 or 3.
If you, yeah. If you got a 1 or a 2 or a 3,
that's
not good.
You have so much material to review and so many videos that I can't look over. Like, even if I ask you right now, I think, I don't know, there's like such a huge amount of review material in the online.
Well, that's true, but I mean, it's a lot shorter if you ask me something and then we have a little back and forth and then it gets fixed up a lot faster than just trying to watch a video. So let's do this one. Evaluate the double integral of x plus 2y dA, where R is the following region. Squared. Okay. So then I'll say instruction one. Set up both iterated integrals. Okay, what does that mean, set up both iterated integrals?
Figure out what's going to be on the outer side,
mm-hmm.
and what your bounds are, and what's on the, which, yeah, where dx and dy.
Okay, well, so that would be doing one of them. So there's another one besides that. So what it is that there's, you can perform, you want to convert this double integral into an iterated integral. That means you're going to convert this two-dimensional integral into a sequence of one-dimensional integrals. This is Fubini's theorem. And so one of the ways is you can do dy dx. Okay, what's the other way? Dx dy. Not quite. So let's do dy dx. That means that we're trying to set up an iterated integral that looks like this. Iterated integral, and we want to fill in these boxes, right? This box, this box, this box, this box, and then x plus 2y. Dy dx. So we got to fill in those boxes. Okay. So what is the outer variable? The outer integral. Right. The x's, right? So the x's are going to be constants. Okay. And the ones inside may not be constant, but the ones outside must be constant. Okay, so in order to do this, let's draw a version, a new copy of this region. Okay. So, because we're integrating with respect to
x. That means that we need to find the, on the outside, we're integrating with respect to x, we need to find the range of all x's to integrate over. So the way we do that is we sweep x values through this region and see where they intersect. So tell me when I start going through the region. Do, 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 do. Oh, right there, right? That's where it starts. Okay, that's the leftmost x value. Now, what is that? What is that x value?
Zero.
This is x is 0. Okay, so I'm, now I'm in the region, and tell me when I get to the rightmost value. Do, 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 do. Right there, right? What is that value? 2. Okay, now I agree with that, but I need you to show me why that's the case. Why is that x is 2? Right. You have to solve an equation. To figure that out, you want to know when are red and blue touching? What are the intersections? To find intersections, you solve an equation. So we want to solve 2x is x squared. So 0 is x squared minus 2x. So 0 is x multiplied by x minus 2. So x is 0 or x is 2. So what are the coordinates of these intersections here? What's this intersection? So what are the coordinates of that point?
0, 0, 0.
0, 0. And what are the coordinates of this point?
2,
0. 2, 0. 2,
4.
Okay, good. Okay. So that means that we're going to go between, so 0 is less or equal to x is less or equal to 2. So now we need to figure out the y's. So y has to be between something also. What are the y's between?
Zero and 2.
Not quite.
The y's are between x and 2x. The x squared and 2x.
Yes. Okay. It's not between 0 and 4. If you say between 0 and 4, that means it's the whole rectangle. So the way that you make this determination is you say, okay, I'm going to draw a line, an x line, between 0 and 2. So for example, this one. Now this one that I just drew, is every bit of that line in the region in question? No, just some of it is, right? So now we need to figure out. So we're going to pass through the region, and you always travel in the positive direction of the line. So tell me when I start passing through the region. Do, 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 do. Okay, right here. So you start at red. Okay, that's where you start passing through the region. And then you pass through the region and do, 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 do. Okay, you stop at the blue. Okay, so then you start at red and stop at blue. So what is the lower bound here? X squared. And what is the upper bound? 2x. So x's are between 0 and 2. Y's are between x squared and 2x. Okay, and that's how you describe that region. So that, yes? A lot.
Really?
Yeah. So if you're talking about quiz 11 question 3, there was a question similar to this, quiz 11 question 3. The ones that are due in 2 days? Right, yeah. And there was another question,
quite similar to quiz 11 question 3 on quiz 14, but that's why I made an announcement. Yeah. So I'll check what happened. I'll try and check, thumb through what happened on quiz 14. And if it's still just as bad as it was on quiz 11, maybe it'll appear on the final also. We'll get it. We'll get it one way or another.
So it's not really going to be the sequence one?
Well, on a quiz, I try and always make it over the previous week's material, unless there was something that's just got to also, if I've got to make up lost ground somewhere. So then this is, so x plus 2y dy dx, okay, and what goes on the limits of the outside integral?
0 to 2.
Right. X is going between 0 and 2. And then how about the inside?
X squared to 2x.
Right. Y is going from x squared to 2x. Okay, now have we satisfied the requirements of part one?
Yes. No.
No.
What are we missing?
What does it say? It says set up both iterated integrals. So that means that one of the iterated integrals is dy dx. What's the other one?
Dx dy.
Dx dy.
You don't solve it this way, right? Wrong. Please look
at our answer. No. So let's be clear. So if this question was just as it's stated here, you could use either one of these. You could use this one or the one we're about to do. It'd be just fine. But specifically on this question, because of quiz 11 question 3 and because of other requests, I'm specifically making you do a lot of work on this example. So on this first part, what was the outside variable?
X.
And then on the one we're currently doing?
Y.
So on the one we were previously doing, it was X's are between constants. What will it be for this one?
Y's will be
between constants. Okay, so let's draw another copy of the region. Okay, so what's the first order of business? Sorry? Okay, so that, I agree, that needs to be done. But what was the first thing that we did here?
See where it
intersects. We already know where they intersect now. We established that. But then after that, we said, the question was, what's the range of X's? That's what we were doing here. So what are we going to do for this one?
What's
the range of the y's? Okay, so then, again, with the silly Jeopardy music. Right? So tell me when I start going through the region. And notice that we're sweeping up now with a horizontal line. So, do, 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 do. Okay, there we go. So then, y is between two values, and the lower value is 0. And then we get in the region, and we're passing through the region now, and you tell me when we get out. So, do, 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 do. Stop, right?
Okay. A little more.
A little more, okay. So then what is this y value?
4.
This is y is 4. And how do you know that?
Solved.
Yeah, because we did that, right? Okay. So now, that means that y's are ranging between 0 and 4. Now you take a y line. And then you're going to trace it in the positive sense of that line. So what is the positive sense? Going to the right or going to the left?
The right.
Going to the right. OK.
Okay, so we'll start over here at the left, and you tell me when we start passing through the region. So do 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 do, right there, right? So we start there at blue. You start at the blue, and then you're in the region. Do 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 do. Okay, then you exit on the red. Okay, so that means that that means that the x values start at the blue and end at the red. So what do we need to write right here?
2x.
Okay, 2x won't work. Because it needs to be in terms of y.
Oh, so it's 2y.
No. So here's the equation. The equation for this blue line is y is 2x. So you need the equation for this, but you it's presently solved for y. You need it to be solved for x.
So y over 2.
Yes, x is y over 2.
Oh, this is tricky.
So y over 2 is what goes right here.
I think a lot of people are going
to use this. Well, that's okay. If we have to if we have to do this question three times, that'll be fine. It's probably going to be graded, because this is an important concept.
Wait, so why again did you have to change it?
Because this needs to be a function of y. So this these x's need to be bounded by functions of y. Just like up here, these y's need this y needed to be bounded by functions of x.
Do
so
we have to put that, like the way you have it written?
This?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
But you do need to do this.
Yeah.
So the equation of this red, that's y is x squared. So what do we need to write?
Y equals x.
Square root x.
X is square root y. Okay, so that means that now that we've set this up, we can write the other iterated integral. So what are the outer limits? Y is 0 to y is 4, and then the inner limits. Very good. Okay, so these two, these are the two different iterated integrals which can tell you the answer for this double integral. And then the longest possible way I could ask a question like this is to say, okay, do this, set them both up, and evaluate them both. I wouldn't do that, but it'd be too much to grade.
So we just need to set it up. Just set it up.
Yeah, for example. Just set it up. And then I could say, you know, if ever I ask a question like this, set them both up, then the follow-up question is, now choose either one of them and evaluate it.
You don't
have to. Oh,
wait.
Yes? Yes, if you've done it correctly, you must get the same thing. It's sort of equivalent to asking like, well, if I painted a wall with vertical stripes and I took 1.3 gallons of paint, how much would it take if I used horizontal stripes? Still got to be 1.3 gallons, unless something is going majorly wrong. Yes?
So for the quiz, you're gonna want us to set both up, but only evaluate one.
Well, just follow the instructions.
Totally.
So the instructions on the quiz question is just this: evaluate this. It looks like this.
Okay.
But because it looked like on the quiz that everyone was having trouble setting up the iterated integrals, then I did it twice here for you, for your viewing pleasure. Right. Other questions? Do we want to see another one of these or something else entirely?
Can you just finish solving that?
Sure.
Does it solve for a number?
Yes, it does. It must, because because it's volume, right? For one thing. And for another thing, because you're integrating with respect to y, when you're finished integrating with respect to y, there'll be no more y's, only x's. And then when you do this, you're integrating with respect to x, there'll be no more x's. So if there's no more x's and there's no more y's, only a number can remain. So I'll do the first one. So pick one. And evaluate. I'll do the first one. So integral 0 to 2. Integral x squared to 2x. X plus 2y dy dx. Okay. So we do the inside integral first. We'll use the fundamental theorem. What is the antiderivative of x plus 2y? With respect to y. xy plus y squared. Good. So any question about that step? This is okay. What is the derivative of, what is the partial derivative of y squared with respect to y?
Antiderivative.
So going this direction is partial derivative. Partial derivative, antiderivative. Okay, so then now we'll replace the y's with two x's. So that would be x times 2x, well that's 2x squared, plus 2x all squared, that'd be 4x squared, and then minus. I'll replace the y's with x squared, so that'd be x cubed, and then plus x to 4. Dx. So notice that now that we've integrated with respect to y, there are no more y's. Okay, so then simplifying a little bit, that'd be 6x squared, so negative x to 4 minus x to 3 plus 6x to 2. And then we can use the fundamental theorem again. Negative x to 5 over 5 minus x to 4 over 4 plus 2x to 3 from 0 to 2. At least one of the points is 0, right? That makes it a little better. So that'd be what, negative 32 over 5 minus 16 over 4 plus 16 and then minus 0. So now this can be simplified a little bit. 16 over 4 is 4. And that's minus 4, and then plus 16, so that's plus 12. Negative 32 over 5 plus 12. Well, 12 is 65ths minus 32 of them, so that'd be 28/5. Is that 5.6? Oh, well, there you have it. What else would you like to see? We still have 30 minutes. Okay. Let's see. The third question on quiz 12?
Maybe. I don't remember what it was.
The one that looks like this?
Yes.
Oh my god,
I don't even know.
Yeah.
I don't even know what to say about that.
Newton something or other? Okay. So let's try and make sure that we understand what's being asked. Let T denote the temperature of an object in a room. Okay, so you got an object in a room, and the room is being held by the air conditioning at a constant temperature. Okay, and there's an object in the room. So Newton's law of cooling says, among other things, that as long as nothing changes, all objects in the room will reach the room temperature as long as there's no external forcing. So like, you know, that light's not going to get to be room temperature, but that's because it has an electrical current flowing through it and it's heating up a little bit. Okay, but if there's nothing forcing anything, the objects in the room are going to reach room temperature. And more specifically, Newton's law of cooling says that the temperature of the object in question is governed by this differential equation. Right here. Okay, so is there any question about the statement of the differential equation? Hopefully not, it's just something I typed in there. Okay, so what it's saying is that the time rate of change of the temperature is proportional to the difference in temperatures. So, for example, if we put an ice cube in here, then it would be warming up more quickly than, say, something that we just took out of the refrigerator, like an apple. Okay. Because presumably the apple's not frozen, right? If the room temperature is 25 degrees, if you take a 0 degree ice cube, it's going to warm up faster than a 15 degree apple. Its instantaneous rate of change will be faster. Okay. So, the first part A says, suppose that you know that K is 1 and R is 25. And that the initial temperature of the object is 100 degrees. So part A is saying that D big T, little t, is 25 minus T. Okay, that's just plugging things in. Okay, and furthermore, we know, yes?
Oh, because K is 1.
Right. So K is 1,
and R is 25. And furthermore, we know that at time, that time temperature 0, 100 is a solution. Okay, so the object in question is not cold; it's hot. So this is a hot. At 100 degrees, if this is in Celsius, this would be like saying, okay, you got a room, and all of a sudden you put a pot of boiling water in the room and a thermometer, and you're going to watch what happens.
So when you're reading this, because I'm not good with these word ones, and it says the initial temperature of the object, just assume that means zero.
Initial means zero, yeah. So initial means that when things began. Okay, so then here's the differential equation. So we can solve it in a variety of ways. So what are the two ways we have to in this class to solve differential equations? So the one you're talking about is if it's separable.
Oh yeah.
And what's the other one?
Linear.
Right, first order linear.
Yeah.
Okay, and the technique to deal with first order linear differential equations is called an integrating factor. Okay, so is this separable?
Yeah.
Yes.
It is separable. So that means that either technique is available to us because this is also first order linear. So what do you want to do?
Which one's easier? I think it's first order linear that's easier, right?
It depends.
I don't know.
It depends on the question.
I would do the just separable one.
Yeah,
you want to do separable. Okay.
You already put this on YouTube, did
it? Yeah, it's up there. So D big T is 25 minus t d little t. And so do we have, are the variables separated? Not yet, right? So then 1 over 25 minus big T d big T is d little t. Okay, so now the big T's and little T's are separated. So now what? Good. Antiderivative. So antiderivative 1 over 25 minus big T d big T is antiderivative d little t. Okay, the right-hand side's easy. I'll do it. So plus C. And then what's the left-hand side? Almost. So what I heard was log. So that it's still almost. So this is not quite right.
Plus C, why is it?
Okay, so then let's do it the long way. Okay, so everybody's okay with this line, right? So only evaluated the right-hand side. So to evaluate the left-hand side, we need to do a substitution. So what is the substitution?
25 minus t.
Good. U is 25 minus t. Okay, then what's du?
Negative dt.
Right. So then you could write du divided by negative 1 is dt. Okay, then you make that substitution and you would have antiderivative 1 over u du divided by negative 1 is t. And so that negative 1 can come out
And then what is antiderivative 1 over u du? Right. And you'll have this negative out in front. So negative log absolute 25 minus t is t, and now I need a plus c. I wrote plus c before because I was intending on doing all of the antiderivatives at the same time. Okay. Now what? Now we can solve for c.
I'll do a negative dt as du.
Here?
Because of the negative t?
Because the derivative of this expression, mm-hmm. 25 minus big T, with respect to big T, is what?
If it was plus t, what would it be? 1.
So the derivative...
Right. Okay, yeah.
Okay, good. So we can figure out c. How can we figure out c?
Raise them.
Now, we could do that, but we don't even need to do that.
Subtract the t from both sides.
What do you think? How do we always figure out the c?
Everything on the other side.
Plug in what?
Something.
Plug in something.
That's all I got.
Well, that was easy.
This, right? The initial data tells you what the C is. So plugging that in, we would have negative log absolute value and then 25 minus big T. Yeah, so 25 minus 100 in absolute value is 0 plus C.
The log of the negative log of
75. Yes, negative log of 75 is C. Okay, so then taking this up here, so that's telling us that negative log absolute 25 minus big T is little t. Plus, no, minus. minus log of 75. Okay, now what?
Solve for t.
Solve for t.
Okay.
No, you don't want to solve for little t.
Oh.
You need to solve for big T.
Well, I have no idea how to do that because it's inside of
the. Well, we're going to have to figure it out. Okay, now. In the video where I was doing this the first time, and the PDF, therefore, I didn't make this comment, but I'd like to point out, okay, something about the absolute value of 25 minus big T. So big T, is that going to be bigger than 25 all the time, some of the time? Is it going to be less than 25 all the time, some of the time? What's the deal?
It's never going to be smaller than 100.
Not quite. It's always going to be bigger than 25. Why should big T, why should the temperature of the object always be bigger than 25?
I just want to know how you can have negative.
Well, because I negated both sides of the equation.
No, I know how you got it there. I'm looking at the top where it tells you that little t, big T equals 0 and 100.
Right.
I'm curious how you can have negative 1 at
t. Well, I mean, that's not really, I'm not really sure why that's relevant.
Because I don't see how you can have little t
I'm thinking of a line.
So let's think back to what this differential equation represents. So imagine that we're in a room that's 25 degrees. That's about room temperature in Celsius. And imagine that we take a pot full of boiling water and we just put it in the room. What will happen to this water?
It will become the room temperature.
It will become room temperature. It will slowly decrease to room temperature.
But it can never be lower than.
It won't get lower than the room temperature.
Yeah, it's not going to get any lower than room temperature, right? That's not the way it works, right? Things don't like, from their heated state, they don't like do a dip and then come back to room temperature. They exponentially decay to the room temperature. Similarly, ice cubes, when they're melting, they don't jump over the room temperature and then cool off.
Okay, that's why there's an absolute value and has to be greater.
Right, but what I'm trying to tell you is that the absolute value of 25 minus T is going to be what?
Greater than 25.
That's true. It's going to be greater than zero. Big T will be greater than 25. But because big T has, because this is a physical problem, big T is going to be bigger than 25. So the absolute value of 25 minus T is going to be T minus 25.
What?
Okay, let's forget that point and let's just continue. How do we solve for big T? How do we get it out of
exponential?
Good. So exponentiate both sides. This would be absolute 25 minus t is exponential negative t times exponential of logarithm 75. Well, what is the exponential of the log of 75?
Oh, you just 75.
It's just 75. Okay, so we want to get that big T out of the absolute value. Well, there's two possibilities. It's either going to be that 25 minus big T is 75 exponential negative T, or 25 minus big T is negative 75 exponential big T. Right, because to drop the absolute values, you have to do plus or minus. So for example, if the absolute value of x was 5, then x needs to be plus or minus 5. Okay, so now let's consider, could both of these be solutions? Probably not, because why would I be asking that otherwise, right?
Well, equaling negative doesn't make sense. And I guess it does. I don't know.
Well, let's think about it. So there is one point that we know must be part of the solution. What must be part of the solution?
Zero,
100. So let's plug in 0, 100 to both of these. What if you plug in big T is 100.
This would be
negative 75. And this would be positive 75.
So then you plug it into the other one.
If you plug it into the other one,
and it works.
This would be negative 75.
And
that would be negative 75.
Okay.
So can you see that there's only one solution? Algebraically, I think you can see it. But what I was trying to tell you about things warming up to room temperature or cooling down to room temperature and not overshooting them. That's algebraically, that's what this is saying. This one, not that one. Okay, so not this one. So the question was, does 0, 100 solve these?
And for this one, the answer is no. And for this one, the answer is yes. So the only solution is 25 minus big T is negative 75 exponential negative T. So negative T is negative 25 minus 75 exponential negative T. And then T is 25 plus 75 exponential negative T.
And that's what we're looking for?
That's the solution. That's the solution to part A.
Oh.
What's the solution to part B?
I don't know.
What was the question for
part B? Yeah, what was the question? So part
goes to infinity.
Yeah, what happens as time goes to infinity? So now let's go back to the physical problem and say that we have a room that has room temperature 25 degrees, and we put a pot of boiling water in it. What will happen to the room temperature? What will happen to the water of the temperature of the water?
It's hotter.
It's
always going to
be the
temperature.
Yeah, it's going to go.
That makes sense now.
So how about this? This 25 is not moving.
Yeah.
This.
If that goes to infinity, it'll
be zero. Yes, this term, this factor as t goes to infinity goes to zero. This goes to zero. So the product goes to zero. So the temperature goes to 25.
So it gets closer to 25.
Yes. So what's being asked is compute what is the limit as t goes to infinity of, as time goes to infinity of temperature. So that's the limit as time goes to infinity.
Oh, we have to actually solve it?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a calculus class. So I wrote exponential negative t as division by exponential t, just so it's really clear. What does this exponential do?
It goes to zero, so then that becomes zero. I wonder how you write.
This goes to infinity.
Infinity, but it's...
But it's being divided, right? So so the answer...
Move it down before you try to speak.
Yeah, it might help.
Even if you don't move it down, if you put...
So that'd be 25, you know, plus zero if you like.
So if you do it the other way, you wouldn't notice that, right?
Do it what other way?
If you just plugged it into negative t, you wouldn't really notice that. It's not a fraction.
Well, it just depends on how you're used to thinking about it. So this exponential is decaying as big, as little t gets big, because it's negated. But I claim that I hope that you see that this makes good sense, right? That's what a pot of water would do if you put it in a room.
So technically, you should understand what you're reading and then what you should know in the very beginning.
What else would you like to see? Yeah.
Are you going to put on there like what problems they're like?
Yes. This is what a written homework looks like. It's got this O1 on it. The quizzes are going to have like O7_03.
Okay.
That means quiz 7, question 3.
Okay.
Thank you. It should be visible.
So they're not the exact same questions.
No, it's not the exact same question. What else would you like to see? We have time for one more.
I struggle with 9-2, but since I asked the last one, I'll let if someone else may have something more pressing.
I was thinking of quiz 7.
7-1?
I mean, that's cool. any of them will help.
So we're going to jump to this 7-1. I mean, if I got 10 out of 10,
we can do 7-1.
7-1, and then 4 on that.
7-1. You're talking about the volume of rotation thingy?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was
all
the one
number.
Yeah, right. I didn't get any of that right.
Okay. Okay. So, I'll just make one up here. The formula for the volume of the solid of revolution of y is f of x about the x-axis on the interval a to b. That's pretty precise, isn't it?
Yeah, too precise.
Well, it's a math class.
Yeah.
So the integral a to b of pi f of x squared dx. So in the end, this is the formula. Okay, so then now what we need is I need to give you a function whose square is integrable. Something that you can anti-differentiate easily. So how about I've got to give you a function. So do this for y is how about e to x plus 1 squared on the interval about log of 2.
Why?
Oh, no.
That's unnecessary.
To log of 3.
Oh, it should be fine though, because there's an e in there, so we're going to talk.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I don't want to. Sorry, I don't want this to be squared. But it's still going to be squared, but it's just not going to be squared right here.
To the fourth.
Well,
because for that question, it's that A was sketched the graph, and B was sketched the solid revolution of K and the revolve here.
Right. So this is what E to X looks like just by itself. So how would Y is E to X plus 1 look? Yeah, it would look just like that, moved up 1.
Rotation around which axis?
The x-axis. And then log of 2, that's, what is that? That's about 0.7. And log of 3 should be a little more than 1. Oh, come on. Yeah, 1.1. So that would be, you know, going to revolve that around the axis. So it would look something like
something like this, like a fancy lampshade thing. And then as for the integral, from log 2 to log 3 of pi e to x plus 1 squared dx. So is there any question why that's the integral that needs to be done?
Because it says it's on log 2 and log 3, right?
Yeah, it says, yeah, from log 2 to log 3. Okay, so what do you do from here?
Why do I have to pull the pi out? Because I don't think
that's true.
Okay. Pi can come out, it's a constant. Now what?
Let's substitute.
Okay, what?
Yes, plus one.
Okay, so are you saying that u is e to x plus 1? What would du be? E to x.
Dx.
Do we have that?
Not that I can figure out.
We don't, right? So remember.
Integration of v.
Integration.
No.
Oh, we don't have to do.
Remember, what's the name? We're trying to compute an antiderivative because we want to use the fundamental theorem, okay, which is the connection between antiderivatives and integrals. So what is the name of the procedure that we use to do antiderivatives?
Integrate.
That's a separate matter. So there's a name for it. It's named after a person. That is a person.
All of calculus.
The Riesz procedure.
Yeah.
Which one was that?
Yeah.
That's where you're trying to do an antiderivative, and what the first step of the Riesz procedure is. Is this one of the antiderivatives that we know? How many do we know, by the way?
Three.
Three. So is this one of the three?
No.
What is the second step?
Algebraic.
Is there anything algebraic you can do?
You can factor it out.
You can
FOIL it out, and that's what you must do.
Okay.
Right? By parts is the very last one in the list. It's like a last resort. Well, yeah, but I'm the one doing this one, right? Yeah. We're doing this one together. Oops.
So, e to the x times e to the x is e to the 2x?
Yes, because
you're adding exponents.
You add exponents.
Oh, you already have. Then you can do each of these individually.
That's right.
So why again did you have to do that and you couldn't use any other thing?
Because
I really was good at it. Like, if it had been me doing this, I would have just done substitution if that wrong. So why can't you do that?
There's you can't do a substitution because there's no, because whatever you select, there's not also a du. So, what's the antiderivative of e to 2x?
It's e to 2x over 2.
Very good.
Okay, so it was
only. And then, what's the antiderivative of 2e to x?
2.
Just 2e to x?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And what's the antiderivative of 1?
X.
X. And then now this evaluated from log 2 to log 3. It's a lot. Okay, so this would be what? So exponential of 2 log 3. Well, what's 2 log 3?
It's 6.
No. Log of 9, right? Because it'd be 3 squared.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then what's the exponential of the log of 9?
9.
So this first one is 9 halves.
Because you can take the number in front and make it an exponent, right? No.
Something like that. Okay.
Same.
So if you plug this in, this would be 2 times 3, that'd be 6, and then plus the log of 3, and then minus. Yeah, the pi is out in front there. So plug in log 2, that'd be, so 2 log 2, that's log of 4, and exponential of log of 4 is 4, and then over 2 is 2. So then this would be, and then plus 2 exponential log of 2, which is 2, that'd be a 4, and then plus log of 2. So that'd be 4.5 plus 6, that's 10.5, and then minus 6, that's 4.5. Yeah, and then plus log of 3 over 2. And then if I was to give you this question exactly, I'd probably say, give it to me to 3 places past the decimal, so you'd have to type that into the calculator.
Wait, you do log when you, wait, what?
Yeah, what happened?
How'd you get log of 3 over 2?
Yeah.
Because this is log of 3 minus log of 2.
Which is the same as the exponent rules, right?
Yes. Because when it's log of a product is the sum of the logs. So log of AB is log A plus log B. And log of A divided by B is log A minus log B. The difference of logs is the log of the quotient.
So did you pick this complicated one? Because by chance, this is probably one that it's going to be on.
Well, we made it up.
I just made it up on the spot. That's it.